Christmas.
So good to see you here this morning, and Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Yeah, what a way to start out the year, being at church. So we expect everyone of y'all to be here next Sunday too. Now. So y'all come on back and be with us. I want to challenge each and every one of us as we begin this new year. I mean, we're here at church. And hopefully we're going to worship like, you know, we've never worshiped before. But it's my prayer that we take this day, the 1st of January 2023, being here at church, and carry it forward in growing in knowledge and admonition of the Lord. So I pray that each one of us can grow so that we can, as individuals, be a better witness for Christ, and we can grow as a church to draw in the lost to be saved by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So this morning, we're going to open up with page 323. I love to tell the story. It's in the church hymnal.
Jesus and
Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Go Dogs. We all need to be in church this morning, I'm just saying. It's good to see everybody. Happy New Year, like I said. You know, it's a great place to start the new year in church with all our church family. We love y'all so much. Want to welcome all our visitors. If you're a visitor here, we want to extend a special welcome out to you this morning. I don't think I have any announcements. I know next Sunday is Brotherhood, 8 a.m. We're still off this week for Wednesday night, correct?
January the 11th
is the next. Okay, so remember January the 11th is when Wednesday nights kick back off.
And tomorrow night, the first Monday night of every month, the WMU meets at 7 o'clock. So we will have our first WMU meeting for the new year. So it'd be a great time if you're not in WMU for y'all to come and join us. So 7 o'clock tomorrow night.
So remember that. Any other announcements? If not, if you'd stand to your feet, if I could get the ushers to come to the front. Caleb Bird, will you pray for us?
Yes, I will. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for another new year. And Father, thank you for letting us gather here together as a church family. Father, I pray that everything we do here today uplifts the name of your Son. And Father, I pray that if there's one here today that has never received your Son as their Savior, as their Lord, Father, I pray that today will be the day. Father, I pray that you uplift our pastor as he brings us your word. And Father, I just pray that you go with us and bless us through this new year. Father, we love you, and it's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If you would turn to page 6 in the church hymnal, I want to know more about my Lord. This should be our theme this year. Spread a little bulldog love. right, that's the cue. Let's sing the last. Here we go.
We promise we this soul ascending. I'm coming back, the Lord did say. They found his promise, you think they did. On wings of love, you'll soar away. I want to know more about my Jesus. I want to know more.
I want to know more
about my Lord, my blessed Lord.
I want to know more.
I want to know more
about that mansion.
Take the church hymnal and turn to page 120. Page 120 of the church hymnal. And we'll sing all three verses.
Save a wretch like me.
anything much, but a friend sent me an article yesterday, and the song we're about to sing, according to this article, it was sung on January the 1st of 1763. And it never gets old. It's always new to me. And if you feel like singing with us, go ahead.
Good morning. Happy New Year. Isn't it good to be alive to see another year? Amen. I told a couple of guys as I was talking earlier, just after Sunday school, I said, well, if a lot of folks made New Year's resolutions to be better church attenders, they must be going to start next Sunday. Amen. Got a lot of empty seats this morning, but that's all right. We hope, we know we've got some sickness and and folks not feeling well, and we've probably got some folks on the road and traveling, and probably some folks that just ain't recovered from last night. Yeah, so there you go. Somebody asked me as soon as I walked in, I think it was Janie Talent, she said, "You mean you can talk this morning?" I said, "I sure can." I didn't get too awfully bad stirred up last night, but it was an exciting game. I'll be honest with you, that's what a championship game or a playoff game should be. You know, we've had some blowouts in the past and things like that, and you think, man, that was kind of one-sided, but yesterday between Michigan and TCU and then Georgia and Ohio State, those were what playoff games really should be. Nail biters right down to the wire. And so it was an enjoyable time, enjoyable game to watch, a little stressing at times, but it was good. And good to see all of you here this morning, and pray that you had a wonderful Christmas and that everything is going good with you, and pray that you have a wonderful new year. I can't believe we're already in a new year. Can you? Isn't that amazing? Enjoyed the singing this morning. It has been beautiful and wonderful as always. And I'm going to pick on Parker Elsie a little bit. I couldn't help but stand there while Parker or sit there while Parker was leading this song. And I started looking at his boots, and I thought, if Parker ever grows into his feet, he's going to be a big old boy. That boy's got some big old feet, you know. And I said, man, them, I believe I could wear his boots. I just believe I could. I thought, he's going to be a big boy when he grows into his feet. So anyway, I love you, Parker. I love all our young folks. We got such a good group and so dedicated, and we appreciate them. And I was asking Caleb about the ones he had in his class this morning, and he had a good number in his class, and I appreciate y'all coming out and taking part in Sunday school. That's how you're going to learn. That's how you're going to learn. That's how you're going to grow. And I don't know if you've read the bulletin yet or not, but the message in the bulletin today, or that I had placed in there on my pastor's page, is I'm just praying that all of us will grow together in a more closer, intimate relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ this coming year. We desperately need that relationship. We desperately need to grow in that relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. If we want to see come to pass what Scott mentioned just a few minutes ago, we are going to have to grow in our individual relationships with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And then it will make a difference. I'm going to pray that people have a desire to come to God's house and to be involved in God's house. Not just to be a number, not just to be a face in the crowd, but to really, you know, seek the Lord and say, Lord, where would you have me serve in your church today? So a lot of things going on in the world, I know that, and a lot of, you know, just flip on the television set or open up a newspaper or anything like that, and it won't take you very long to find bad news. Amen? It won't take you very long to find bad news at all. And so we got a lot to pray for in this coming year, and the church, I believe, will play a vital role in things that happen in our future and people coming to know the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, if we will hold on to the truth. So here we go again. Yeah, well, that's right. Here we go again, because we're not finished with truth. We've talked about the truth of the matter for a couple of Sundays now. We're going to talk about it today, because I don't think it could be hammered enough to realize what the truth of the matter really is. A lot of things being thrown around out there in the world today and being put off as truth. But I'm going to tell you something. The Bible says, woe to those that call evil good. You hear what I'm saying? That call evil good. And there's a lot of evil today that's being called good. There's a lot of evil today that's being accepted by the church. There's a lot of evil today that's going on that we just kind of sweep under the rug, and it's, you know, things that used to you know, man, it used to be taboo. You just didn't hear about things like that, and now all of a sudden, man, it's just right in our face each and every day, and our young people are really bombarded with it in a big, big way. So we got a lot to pray for in this coming year, that we will stay true. That word true, I read the definition a couple of Sundays ago. We're going to read it again. That word true means consistent with fact or reality, not false or erroneous. It's exactly conforming to a rule, a standard, or a pattern. It's reliable. It's accurate. It's real. It's genuine. It's honorable. It's upright. It's rightly, truthfully, unswervingly, exactly. That's what true is. The word truth, of course, means conformity to fact or actuality. It means fidelity to an original or a standard. Reality, actuality, a statement proven to be or accepted as true. Sincerity, integrity, and here's my favorite, truth is God. I like that. Truth is God. So, as we think about truth and we think about, the truth of the matter and, you know, and how it seems that somehow or another the lines in a lot of areas have become blurred and become grayed, God didn't have anything to do with that. The Word's very clear that He is not the author of confusion. What He said in His Word still stands true today. If we would just believe it, abide by it, and live it, then I believe it would make a difference. I believe it would change people's lives. I believe they would be under conviction for their lifestyles and things as we all need to be for the things that we do that go against and contrary to the Word of God. In other words, sin that we all have to deal with. And if we'll deal with that sin in our own personal lives and stop looking down our noses and condemning everybody else for what they've done, you know, as the old saying goes, sweep up and clean up our own doorstep first, then I think the church can go forward and we can make a difference in this lost and dying world. I've been reading, and I'm going to, Janice Talent gave me, she knows I like history, she knows I like to read, and she gave me a little volume. It's called the Jefferson Bible. Some of you may have heard of it. And that's not what he called it. He called it the Morals of Jesus of Nazareth, I believe is what he called it. But it came to be known as the Jefferson Bible. The reason it came to be known as the Jefferson Bible is because he took the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and he cut out the parts he liked and pasted them on blank pages and left the rest of it out. Because in his mind, if it couldn't be reasoned out with human thinking, if he couldn't reason it out reasonably with the human mind, it didn't make sense, he did away with it. Therefore, he didn't believe in the resurrection. He didn't believe in things like, you know, he doesn't even include the angel's announcement of the birth of Christ and all of that kind of stuff. He just left it out. He ends his little Jefferson Bible with that Jesus had died and they buried him, and that's it. He did not accept the deity of Jesus Christ. Didn't accept it. You know, to him, to be a good moral person, you didn't have to be the Son of God. You know what? I guess that's true, but my goodness gracious. How can you say you're a Christian if you don't even believe that he was God's Son, that he was God in the flesh, God with us? And so he conveniently, and I mean it's very obvious, you can see where he clipped out sections, and there's a picture of one of the Bibles that he butchered up where he cut out the sections he accepted and left the rest of them aside and pasted them in his little volume. And that became his Christianity. That became his truth. That's what I'm getting at. But you can't have truth if you don't have the Son of God. You can't have truth unless you have the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. You can't have, there is no salvation outside the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible's very clear that there is no salvation. There is no other name given under heaven whereby men must be saved, save the name of Jesus Christ. That's the truth. That's the truth. I'm not telling you not to read it. I'm not telling you it's not. It's a very, very, Janice and I talked at length about it the other day. It's a very interesting read. He was a very intelligent man. He obviously spent a lot of time, but he spent a lot of time concocting his truth as far as what the Bible said. To him, it wasn't the inerrant Word of God. It was simply the teachings of a good moral person, Jesus Christ. His truth became what he wanted it to be. I've also been reading in a book that I received from the North American Mission Board. It's by a fellow named Trevin Wax. I don't know him, had never heard of him until I received this book. But it's called The Thrill of Orthodoxy. You say, wow, how can you get thrilled about orthodoxy? The thrill of orthodoxy, rediscovering the adventure of Christian faith. And if I believe any, if I know anything today, you and I need to rediscover the adventure of what we believe. Somehow or another, we've lost the excitement. We've lost the zeal. We just kind of show up and go through the motions to get by as best we can. And as I've gotten into this little book, I'm like, man, this guy, he's not giving us any new way, some newfound way of doing something. He's going back to the basics. He's going back to the way it started out. Rediscovering, notice that, not discovering some new, but rediscovering what was already there, what we already have. Rediscovering the adventure of the Christian faith. And if you and I could begin to look at what we believe, if you and I could begin to look at our Christian faith as an adventure, I believe it'd make a difference in how we live our lives. We all like an adventure, amen? We all like to go and experience things and all like that. Well, what's wrong with going back and re-experiencing the adventure of what we already know and what we know we believe? And just solidifying that in our hearts and in our minds so that we can hold on to the truth and not let the lines between black and white get kind of muddled into something kind of grayish looking, which I believe is what's happening today. I want to share with you some things. Just bear with me. He says the adventure of boundaries. You know what a boundary is? Well, I'm going to tell you. A boundary is something that points out or shows a limit or an end. It's a dividing line. It indicates or fixes a limit or an extent. It's something like a river, a fence, or an imaginary line that shows where one area ends and another area begins. That's a boundary. We know what a boundary is, right? But go ahead and tell you what a rule is. A rule is a prescribed guide for conduct or action. It's a regulation, a bylaw, governing procedure, or controlling conduct. It's a regulating principle. It's a legal precept or doctrine. That's what a rule is. Boundaries and rules. And we live in a day in a society where it seems to be the popular thing is to abandon. You know, we don't want any boundaries. We want to live our reality. We want to live our truth. We want to build our life and do things our way. We don't want some book telling us how we ought to live and things we ought to do and things we ought not to do. I'm going to be honest with you. We all know what the speed limit signs said on the highway, but how many of us follow the speed limit? If the speed limit's 55, how many of us go 65? If the speed limit's 70 miles an hour on an interstate, how many catch ourselves running 80 and 85? Don't you sit there and lie to me. It's the truth. We know what the law says. We know what the limit is, but we want to push it. Don't tell me I can't do this. Don't tell me I can't do that. It might be true to you, but hey, I don't believe that, so it's not true to me. And we even do that within our Christian faith. We pick and choose what we're going to believe and what we're going to accept as truth, and the rest of it we just kind of let set by the wayside. But if all of it's not true, is any of it true? If there's two or three verses in there that's not so, is there any of it we can depend on and rely on and really put our faith and hope and trust in? If John 3:16 isn't true, if the resurrection of Jesus Christ isn't true, if the virgin birth is not true, is any of it true? If original sin, if we don't believe that we was born with a sin nature, is any of the rest of the book true? Can we really rely on it? Can we really depend on it? Does it really mean anything? Or is it just some made up something by a good moral person that decided to write some things down that maybe somebody would get some good out of one day? Is it God's word or is it not? Is it the truth or is it not? Because if any of it's false, it's all false. Amen? Let me read you what this guy says about boundaries. Here's the thing, he says, about discovering the truth. Discovering the truth. Not just mine or yours. As soon as we encounter truth, we confront falsehood. The existence of truth implies the reality of error. Clear lines of distinction show up. The appeal of inventing our own personal religious identity is that we draw all the lines. We decide what beliefs fit us, what heroes and examples make it into our circle, and what practices we will adopt. And that's exactly what our former president, Thomas Jefferson, did when he created his little Jefferson Bible. He created his own truth. He took out the parts he wanted to believe or did believe and left out the rest of it. It's just a fact. You can get one of those little volumes and read it for yourself. It's a sad truth. He wasn't the only one in his day that believed that. Caleb and I were talking, and we've always talked about how our nation was founded as a Christian nation. Well, there were believers. There were people that came over here to get away from religious persecution. They came over here to be able to worship as they felt they needed to worship. They came over here to enjoy freedom of that religion. And by all accounts, as best I can tell, Thomas Jefferson was a champion of religious freedom. We have a debt of gratitude to him for that. But I'm going to tell you something. Not everybody that says that lives under the label of Christian is a Christian. You say, that's hard, preacher, and you're judging. No, I'm not judging. What does the Bible define as a believer? Can you be a believer if you don't even believe that the one that died on a cross and shed his blood, that he didn't rise again? Can you be a believer if you don't believe that that blood that he shed forgives us of our sins? Can we be a believer if we don't believe that he was born perfect by a virgin that had never known a man? Can we be a true believer if we don't even believe that we have a sin nature? If I don't have a sin nature, why do I need a Savior? Amen? If I'm not a sinner, I don't need anybody to die on a cross for me. I'll just be a good moral person, do the best I can, and hope for the best. But he says, the adventure of discovering truth, however, is different from invention. We don't set the boundaries, we merely recognize them. Biblical Christianity is about the discovery of truth, and so too, rejection of error. Don't miss this part. That's why throughout the New Testament, the apostles made clear distinctions between truth and falsehood. They were unafraid to delineate between the lines between people in the faith and people who by their actions and their beliefs demonstrated they were outside the faith. Those guys just laid it on the line. Those guys made it clear. They didn't sugarcoat anything, right? This kind of line drawing over religious conviction strikes many as counterproductive, and here's where we are today, I believe. Shouldn't the impulse of Christianity lead us to greater inclusiveness? Shouldn't we be in the business of erasing lines and tearing down walls? That would be the case if religion were little more than individual spirituality or a personal preference, like choosing one flavor of ice cream over another. He says, who would judge someone for preferring chocolate chip cookie dough to moose tracks? I don't know which one of them I'd like better. He says, this is what he's getting at. The attitude seems to be to erase the lines and welcome all who like any kind of ice cream. In other words, just anything goes. Let's just do away with the lines, and that way we can build up our numbers. We can get more. We can be more inclusive, and we can just bring everybody in, irregardless of what they believe. Whether they believe the virgin birth, whether they believe in original sin, whether they believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Let's just have a big social gathering and include everything. He says, but the New Testament doesn't portray the gospel in terms of personal preference. Amen to that. The gospel is about events. Listen to this. World-shattering historical happenings that require a reckoning and lead to the point of decision, what will we do with Jesus? Isn't that good? What will we do with Jesus in 2023 and further? What will we do? He said it's true that following Jesus and pledging our allegiance to Him as our Lord breaks down human-made walls, but it builds other ones at the same time. Christianity tears down walls between people kept apart by lesser distinctions, as in Galatians chapter 3, Jew or Gentile, slave or free, male and female. It tears those walls down, puts us on equal footing at the foot of the cross. But at the same time, it erects other walls, delineating sharply between those who confess Jesus as Lord and those who reject Him. This is the paradox of orthodoxy. Listen to this. The gospel both raises walls, R-A-Z-E-S, which means destroys to the ground, and it also raises, R-A-I-S-E-S, walls, that is, builds them up. Lesser walls between Christians are demolished, while the boundaries between Christians and the world are strengthened. You get it? The same gospel tears walls down between individuals and makes us capable of being able to witness and win people to the Lord Jesus Christ, irregardless of their economic standing, their race, their culture, whatever. The gospel puts us on equal footing, male, female, bond or free, rich or poor. But at the same time, it ought to build those walls up and make us stand on the truth of God's Word. All the same gospel. He says lines and boundary markers are not meant to shackle us. Rules and boundaries not meant to shackle us, but to make us free. He talks about building codes. How many of us like building codes, man? They're fine until we're trying to build something, and then they start interfering with the process, right? But building codes are there for a reason. They're there to make something's done right, make sure it's done right. They're there so that we're safe, so that we have a good home with good electrical, good plumbing. That's the purpose they serve. He said he and his father went to the country of Romania and they went up a set of steps. And he said, you know, here it's just taken for granted. You've got railings that you can hold on to. Well, his dad reached for a railing. There wasn't one there and he almost fell about 10 or 12 feet. The building codes didn't require rails. He said, that didn't make us feel more free. It made us feel less free. He said, we were scared. He said, everywhere we went, my dad was saying, make sure you hold on to something. Make sure you don't fall. He said, they're there for a reason. He said, imagine a basketball court with no lines. He said, imagine a football field with no yardage markers. Everybody just runs up and down the field hoping for the best. What kind of chaos would that create? The players are able to enjoy the game because they follow the rules. There's a reason for all of it. We have the truth of God's Word so that you and I can live the freedom in the kingdom of God like He wants us to and be the people that He wants us to be. Not to hinder us or to hold us back, but to set us free, to win the world to Jesus Christ. Ben, I'm sorry, but I listened in a little bit on your lesson today as I was sitting there in my office and Ben made a comment. He said, I just don't see things getting much better. Gloomy Gus. I love Ben. Sometimes I feel just like that myself. But then I look at my grandbabies and I see them little smiling faces. And I say, God, help me make a difference. I want them to have a good life. I want them to know you. I want them to have opportunities that I've had. And the only way that's going to happen is if you and I step up. Amen. The only way that's going to happen is if we try to figure out, Lord, what in the world? Lord, what are you doing? Where are you working? God, I want to be on board. I want to be part of it. I want to make a difference. I want to see every empty pew in this house filled up on Sunday morning. I want to see Miss Gail standing in front of an absolutely slap full and running over choir loft. I want to see Sunday school well up over 100 like it ought to be. And it can be. It could be. I want to see people committed. I want myself to be more committed. But to what? My own truth? Pick and choose what I want to believe and leave the rest of it out? Tiptoe around the hard parts? Trying not to offend somebody? Is that what you want your pastor to do? Well, preacher, people won't come if we... Well, it's not our job to save them. But we are supposed to be fishers of men. You say, you ever going to get to some scriptures? Yes. John chapter 18. You say, what? What an odd place. Jesus has been arrested. He's taken to Annas' house. He's taken from Annas' house to Caiaphas' house, the high priest during that time. They're throwing all kinds of accusations at him. They're making up, oh man, you talk about a mockery of a trial. They're trying to throw something out there to the stick, but they can't even get two or three witnesses to agree. So they decide they're not getting anywhere, so they load him up and take him over to Pilate's house. Maybe the Roman governor can do something about the situation. He's the only one that's really got the authority to crucify him anyway. We'll take him and we'll stir up and we'll accuse him of claiming to be a king, and we'll get some kind of rebellion started, and maybe he'll crucify him so that that won't happen. So they take him over to Pilate's house, and Pilate begins to question Jesus. And in chapter 18 of the book of John, beginning with verse 33, then Pilate entered into this judgment hall again and called Jesus and said to him, art thou the king of the Jews? Are you who they're saying you say you are? And Jesus answered him, sayest thou this of thyself, or did others tell it thee of me? Is this something you've come up with, or did you hear it from somebody else? Pilate answered him, I, Jew? Thine own nation and the chief priests have delivered you unto me. What have you done? Jesus answered, my kingdom's not of this world. What he's telling Pilate is, look, you don't have anything to fear from me. I'm not here to uprise and overthrow Rome. My kingdom, you've got it all wrong. They've got it all wrong. Their truth is not my truth. And isn't it like that in the world today? Isn't that my goodness. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence. And Pilate therefore said unto him, art thou a king then? Jesus answered, thou sayest I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world. I'm here to do what God sent me to do. I'm here to do what I'm supposed to do. But my kingdom's not of this world. For this cause came I into the world that I should bear witness. Listen to this, that I should bear witness, that I should tell the truth. That's what Jesus told Pilate. I'm here to bear witness to the truth. Everyone that is of the truth hears my voice. Pilate said unto him, what is truth? And that's the question that the world still asks today. What is truth? And unfortunately, too many people do exactly what Thomas Jefferson did, and they just make their own truth. They pick and choose. They cut out the parts they don't like, and they put... Let me tell you how far he goes. You remember an episode in Jesus' life when he was 12 years old? We go from his birth until the time he was probably around a toddler when the wise men paid their visit. And the next thing we know, we jump to he's 12 years old, and they've made their journey to Jerusalem, and they stay there, and then they're on their way back home, and they go a couple of days' journey, and they just, Mary and Joseph assumes Jesus is with some of the family. Well, they realize he's not. They go all the way back to Jerusalem. And where do they find Jesus? They find him in the temple. And he's not just asking questions. He's giving answers. And they are absolutely blown away. And they can't believe it. They said, "What, son, why did you do this? We've been all this time wondering where you are. We've been scared to death." And you know what Jesus said? "Did you not know I must be about my Father's business?" You know what Thomas Jefferson did with that part? He just cut it out. And he jumps right to, he just went with them back to Nazareth and was subject to them. Leaves out the part about, "Don't you know I must be about my Father's business?" That didn't fit his reasoning. Church, we're either going to believe it or we're not. Ain't going to make it halfway. You're not going to make it halfway. You're not going to do something with God and not believe it all or believe none of it. "Well, preacher, you know, we're living in a different age. That was written a long time ago, and times have changed, and the culture has changed, and people's attitudes have changed, and the world ain't like it used to be." No, the world is exactly like it's always been. It's been a sinful place. And the world has always dealt with sin, just like it is today. And the things that we blows our mind today, they dealt with it in Jesus' day. Do we understand sin is still sin? That's the truth. That's the truth. We can't pick and choose. Pilate said, "What is truth? I hear what you're telling me. I hear what they're telling me. What is the truth?" Jesus could have said, "Well, you're looking at him. Here I am." Which leads me to the comment I wrote down from my... I've told y'all, I've shared with y'all before... There's a little website called gotquestions.org. This is what it said about John 18. "As a Roman governor in Judea, Pilate's primary responsibility was to maintain peace and order, because he knew if he didn't, he wouldn't keep his job very long. He had a job of prominence. He was a respected member of society in the Roman Empire. That had, I'm quite sure, it had its benefits to it. So he wanted to keep his job. The Jewish high council wanted to put Jesus to death, so they sent him to Pilate because he alone had held the power to pronounce a death sentence, that death being by crucifixion. The high priest Caiaphas had to convince Pilate that Jesus was a troublemaker and a threat to Roman stability. He accused Christ of claiming to be a king, a charge that would insinuate Jesus in the crime of recruiting rebel forces to launch a revolution against Roman authority. Caiaphas hoped to avoid a rebellion. Pilate would determine to put Jesus to death. But what did Jesus say? Let's go back to John 18:36. "My kingdom is not of this world." So you see, they were telling their version of the truth, but they didn't really know the truth. The Lord hit on the word truth as if to say, "The real truth is this, Pilate. They want me dead because they are horrified by the truth of my claim that I am, the promised Jewish Messiah. And therein lies the problem today." You can't accept. Boundaries, rules. I mean, how many of us, when we were growing up, and you'd play a game, and there seemed to be always somebody that wanted to change the rules or wanted to, you know, bend them a little bit or step outside the box and all that kind of stuff. And it didn't just, I mean, it affected the whole game. It affected everybody. Rules are there for a purpose. How many of you have ever played Monopoly? I'm telling you what's the truth. That game drives me nuts. Because I can't ever seem, you know, I'll start off with a pot load of money and I always wind up broke. And my wife's sitting over there, you know, with a big old fat pile of cash, and, you know, and I'm like, you know, and finally it's like, okay, here, you can just take everything I've got left, which is very little, and you can have it. But there's rules. You know, you play by the rules, and sometimes you don't like them, but it's the way it is. People don't want to play by the rules anymore. They don't want boundaries. The church is not popular because the church, to them, seems to be a restricting place. I can't live my life like I want to, so I don't really want any part of that. But if I can go to church and there's no boundaries, I can go to church and pick and choose what I want to hear and what I want to believe, and I can get my ears tickled a little bit, then I'm all for it. I'm good with that. And isn't that the truth with all of us? Let me sit down and you tell me something good about myself. Let me sit down and you tell me some, you know, something that makes me feel good about me. Don't tell me something's going to convict me of sin and tell me I need to repent and I need, you know. Pilate said, what is truth? The world's still asking today, what is truth? What are we going to tell them? What are we going to tell these young folks that's bombarded every day with a homosexual agenda, gay marriage, fornication, by the way, sex outside of marriage? The Bible condemns it. Adultery, the Bible condemns it. I like to pick out sins that other people do. You know what I'm saying? I like to point them out. But don't talk to me about mine. Greed and gluttony. Nobody gluttoned any this past Christmas, did they? Nobody ate more than you should have. So what are we going to tell people when they ask us, well, what does your church believe about so-and-so? And it's coming, if it ain't already. I promise you, it's coming. We don't be mean to anybody. We don't be hateful. We don't be condemning. But we have to love the world enough to tell the world the truth. If we don't tell them the truth, if the church can't tell them the truth, who's going to? Because we know what the world's truth is. We know what their version is. We know how they've cut out and pasted and this and still call themselves Christian. Preacher, there you go judging again. How do you know if somebody's, well, it's, you know, I understand it's between everybody and the individual, but the Bible says, guess what? You will know them by their fruits. I don't care how big a country music star they are. What kind of Hollywood icon? Don't start throwing Bible verses at me trying to, you know, justify calling evil good. What are we going to tell people? What are we going to tell our children, our grandchildren? Are we going to tell them the truth? Are we going to sit down like Thomas Jefferson did and take our little penknife and start cutting out sections that we don't like and pasting the good ones on some blank pages and making our own little volume? You ought to see that. It's a neatest looking little book. And I'll thank Janice again for giving it to me. It's opened my eyes to some things. It's well worth the read. When you see how much trouble an individual went to take out the parts he didn't like. And that's it. That's what he did. He took out the parts he didn't like. He took out the parts that he couldn't reason right here. Well, if that's what you're going to go by, just throw it all out. You know what he called the parts he didn't like? He called it the dung heap. Wow. I believe this, but the rest of this is the dung heap. It's the manure pile. Wonder how that held up when he drew his last breath. A great mind, intelligent man, leader of this nation, president of the United States of America. And yet that's what he believed. Isn't it sad? I know there'll be some that'll condemn me. There might be some that watches this online and they'll have my head. But what does the truth say? Can you be saved if Jesus is not the Son of God? Can you be saved if he was not virgin born? Can you be saved if you don't even believe that you were born in original sin? People's asking those questions, what we going to tell them? We going to give them answers they want to hear so we can build up our numbers? Or are we going to be truthful? We going to tell them the truth of the matter. And the truth of the matter hurts sometimes, doesn't it? The truth of the matter convicts me sometimes when I sit down to read God's Word. The truth of the matter convicts me when I look at my life and I see what a failure I have been. But I don't want to start taking and cutting out that part and saying, no, I won't have it, because I've come to realize I've got to have it all. I need it all. Some have drawn the conclusion that we've got the New Testament now, and that's all we need to focus on, because that's where salvation is. We don't necessarily, you know, the Old Testament's okay, but as long as you've got the New, let me tell you something, you can't fully understand the New until you understand the Old. Study the Old, and it'll lead you up and make you appreciate the New that much more. That's the truth. That's the truth. While we stand and sing today, I don't know what your need is as you start out this new year of 2023. But if you need this altar for something, that's what it's here for. Come and pray and seek the Lord. If you need to be saved, come and be saved today. Just believe and receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. Confess your sin. Admit that you're lost. Believe that he died on a cross and shed his blood, and then confess him as your Savior. A, B, C. Simple as that. Won't you come today while we sing? What's your number, Scott?
Page 385. Softly and
telling you to, you know, the Bible's very clear that we have to draw the lines. But if we completely separate ourselves from a sinner, you say, how can we win them to the Lord? Well, I'm not telling you to completely separate. I'm just telling you to be careful as to who influences who. Remember we talked about the prodigal son? Found himself in the pig pen, but he wasn't a pig. He didn't enjoy the pig pen. He wanted out. That's what I'm getting at. If we're a child of God, we won't enjoy the pig pen. We want out. And if we want out bad enough, we'll want the one that's down there in there. We want them out too. We don't want anybody lost in the pig pen. We want them to be saved. We want them to come to know Jesus as their Savior. Love people. Love the Lord, the Bible says, with all of our heart, mind, body, and spirit, right? And then what does Jesus say? And the next one says, love your neighbor as yourself. He said, on these two, you can hang all the law and the prophets. Love God first, love our neighbors next. Man alive, what a difference it can make. What a difference. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you for praying for this service. Go praying, come back praying. Remember, won't be any services Wednesday night. We'll start back up on January the 11th, the following Wednesday. Enjoy the new year, and we look forward to being back together. God bless you is our prayer. Am I forgetting anything? Conference today. We'll meet for a few minutes, all of you that can hang around for our conference service, and we'll take care of that. And if you can't, we understand. Thank you for coming. God bless you is our prayer. And before we go, I do feel like we need to pray. And Scott, will you pray for us, please?
Our precious Savior, our Father in heaven, I thank you, Lord, for who you are. I thank you, Lord, that you never give up on us. I thank you, Lord, that you love us in spite of us. Father, I pray as we go into a new year that we would ever draw closer to you, Lord, and strive with every step that we take to not take our eyes off of you. I know that I need you more. I don't know. I guess I've reached a place where, Father, I need you more than I've ever needed you before. So, Father, I pray that change starts with me. Thank you for each one that is gathered here today.
Yes.
And I pray that they will have the desire to know you more in this coming year, Lord. Thank you so much for them being here, for placing that desire to be here in their hearts today,
yes,
Lord.
Yes.
Because I know, speaking for me, that if it was just me making the decision, I'd just stay home and stay in bed and not come. But I'm thankful for that desire. I'm thankful for that love that I feel from each one of these people that are here, and most of all from you, Lord. And I thank you and praise you for that. And I love you, Lord. Go with us now into each one of our daily walks, Lord. May we always be found lifting you up and glorifying you, Lord, because it's all about you and building up your kingdom. So forgive us when we fail you, Lord. Thank you again for loving us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank y'all.